Hey gang, and welcome back. Just a reminder, you can now use the promo code MTGMudsta, all caps, at FlipsideGaming.com. You'll get 10% off orders over $10 and help with the channel at the same time. Holy crow, Battle Bond is amazing! Welcome back gang to my top 10 most excited for cards from Battle Bond. If you're anything like me, you are pleasantly surprised to see as many wonderful reprints and new cards coming our way with the release of Battle Bond. Better still, these are going to be cheap as heck and available almost everywhere. If you're anywhere on social media, you'll probably have come across Commander Masters as a joking name for the set, but I really think that's the case. With fantastic uncommons and commons, amazing rares and mythic reprints, I think we're all in for a real treat. But enough blathering, let's look at my top 10, starting with some honorable mentions. The first card on my honorable mention list is actually 5 cards, and it's the rare land cycle from Battle Bond. While these probably won't see the most play in other constructed formats, I think these are going to be fantastic lands for EDH, since chances are you're always going to have two or more opponents. This means, barring a few games where you're playing one-on-one, or you're in a situation where you've killed all your other opponents except for one, these are going to come into play untapped, and I'm always down for that. I do wish we saw the enemy cycle of these lands, but unfortunately 10 rare lands might have been too much for a supplementary set. Now, let's get into the list. Number 10, Will and Rowan Kenrith. I put these two on the list together because frankly, I never see myself playing them as commanders individually, and only ever as a pair. I may consider putting Will into a deck, but at 6 mana he's a lot. What I really like about these planeswalkers is their ultimate and Will's minus ability. Copying spells and activated abilities, as long as they're not mana abilities, is always a very powerful effect, and I can see these being very useful in EDH. Both of their upticking abilities aren't particularly good, but if you're able to resolve them with something like Pier or Doubling Season on the field, you're gonna be cooking with gas. Thinking about it, these two might actually be a precursor to Commander 2018. We know there are going to be planeswalkers involved, and we know they're going to be enemy colored. Having paired single color commander cards that are also planeswalkers will allow for a large design space, since you can use them together, and at the same time, use them individually as the heads of their own respective decks. This means with only the figurehead cards of the planeswalker commanders alone, you'll be able to build 3 different decks. One deck that's paired with them together, and one deck with each of them by themselves. At least, that's my theory anyway right now. Number 9, Thrilling Encore. We've seen this kind of effect with Grim Return already, but basically being able to bring back all creatures from a board wipe is a very fun thing, especially at instant speed. It's kind of like the ultimate Rattlesnake card, where your opponents are basically going to use a board wipe to deal with your creatures, but not only are you able to save them, you're able to steal any other creatures that are on the field. I think the 5 mana spot is pretty sweet for this, and only having one colored symbol is really easy to achieve in EDH. It could also work really well with Ashnod's Altar, allowing you to sacrifice your board for tons of colorless mana, then paying only some of it to return them all back, and then do it again, setting yourself up for a very lethal X spell. Number 8, Bonus Round. So this is a card that I'd been discussing with Harry and Trevor a lot, because they both have very spell-slingy decks in Melek and Ikra and Vile Smasher. It's definitely not something you want to cast when your opponents have tons of blue mana open, but it can be a definite enabler if your deck is very spell-slingy. It's the kind of card you'll have to save in your hand until you're about to win, because you'll never want to cast it early and only cast one or two spells off of it. Basically, at that point, you might as well just be running Reverberate. It's a fun card, and I'm really hoping to see it in action. Number 7, Stolen Strategy. Boy oh boy, do I love this enchantment. I pretty much love anything in red that allows me to steal the top card in an opponent's library, not just necessarily to cast it, but also just to mess with them. I think in recent years, Wizards has definitely taken into account EDH, since this enchantment allows us to spend mana as any color, and basically be able to cast anything we might exile. I will definitely be putting this in my Zedru deck, just don't ask me what I'm cutting for, because that's a nightmare and a headache and oh my goodness, I don't want to think about it. Number 6, Arena Rector. So, I love Academy Rector. I love cheating out enchantments that are huge and powerful and amazing, and people do some ridiculous things with Academy Rector. Is this card Academy Rector? Definitely not. But being able to cheat out a planeswalker at instant speed is very interesting. My main issue with it though is unfortunately you're never going to want to do it except for just before your turn, as you're never going to be able to get an activation out of the planeswalker, except for in the most extreme circumstances where you have some kind of emblem like Teferi's. This means you never want to pop it when you have a couple more opponents to go, because they'll probably attack the planeswalker and kill it before you get to use it. Number 5, Krav the Unredeemed. Now, I definitely like that he partners with a creature that creates tokens when you gain life, but I think Krav the Redeemed is probably better than its angel counterpart. Typically when it comes to sacrificing creatures, I like my outlets to be free, but for only one black and the ability to sacrifice multiple creatures at the same time, I think Krav could definitely be an inclusion in some of my decks. Plus, he draws cards, gains life, and makes himself bigger. Plus, he's a demon, which for a Shadowborn Apostle deck is probably a good inclusion. This is easily my favorite partner with card in the entire set, and I'm really excited to see it in play. Number 4, Stunning Reversal. My goodness, there are a lot of very good black cards in this set. I don't know if you can hear it, but I've got a huge smile on my face, and that's because I love everything about this card. It's so in theme with what black wants to do. Drawing cards, saving yourself by the skin of your teeth, cheating your opponents out of a valid kill. Ugh, it's so good. Flavor win for days. Super awesome, such a fun card, and yes, it exiles itself, but let's face it, if it didn't, you'd be returning this to your hand and recurring it every time you could. Number 3, Sentinel Tower. So, like I said a second ago, Aetherflux Reservoir is a card I like, and Sentinel Tower is a very similar card. You don't gain life, which is probably okay, but being able to do one incremental damage increasing every time you cast a spell is a fantastic way to deal with any target you want. That's right. Planeswalkers, creatures, players, you name it, you can hit them. It'll definitely be limited to the decks that play it, since instants and sorceries aren't in abundance in every deck, but will very much abuse it as much as they can. Number 2, Bramble Sovereign. It's almost like Wizards saw my Trestani deck and was like, hey, we need to give you easier ways to make token copies of good creatures. And they did, and it only cost me 4 mana to cast him, and then 2 mana to do so. Sign me up. There's also the political element to it, as you're able to copy opponent's creatures and give them a second copy. So let's say there's a troublesome artifact or two on the field, and one of your opponents casts Acidic Slime. You could make a deal with them and pay the 2, allowing them to get 2 Acidic Slimes in favor for them blowing up 2 of those problem things. I'm probably as excited about this card as most people are for True Name Nemesis finally being in foil, and I can't wait to jam this into about every single green deck that I own. And my number one favorite EDH card from Battlebond coming out is Spellseeker. For only 3 mana, tutoring a card to the top of our library would be good. But no, no, this tutors it to our hand. It does have its restrictions, costing 2 or less, but let's think of the really good 2 or less costing spells. Cyclonic Rift, Mana Drain, Counterspell, Enlightened Tutor, Mystical Tutor, Vampiric Tutor, Worldly Tutor. The list goes on, and being able to tutor it to our hand is incredible. Plus, this is a wizard, which is a relevant tribal type, especially in EDH. And while not completely irrelevant, she's a 1-1, which means that she can die to Skullclamp and draw us 2 cards if we need her to. This card is the real deal. I think it's probably going to be the most excited for and sought after card, outside of the reprints. It's incredibly costed, it's got a powerful effect, and it does what blue wants to do, which is tutor for instants and sorceries. To summarize, this set is incredible. I am so excited to see it hit the shelves, and I'm probably going to be picking up a box or two to open myself, not to mention buy a bunch of singles. This set to me is what a master set should strive to be. It's affordable, it's got so many incredible reprints and power and fun new cards, and I just really, really, really hope to see more of this in the future.